with you. He started off at motorcycles, dirt track. And he won, but it wasn't enough. So he went to four wheels, which he said was the greatest day of his life because now he had four wheels to go kick people's ass.
Oh, he'd go even quicker.
So we started off in the Morgan Plus Four. Hey, did okay in that. Went to the TR2, board and stroke. Did pretty good in that, but he couldn't help but hear the thunder of the 36 Corvettes over the hill. And those were the days when the Corvettes were king. And he wanted to be a part of that. So we'd go to the races, and he watched the fiberglass fly, and he bought last year's championship car. And guess what this guy did in 2 years? He won 30 of 32 races. So when Carroll Shelby got his attention and said, Bob, you want to come race for me? That was an interesting character, Carroll Shelby, you've never met him. So Bob went to Carroll Shelby, won races for him. Shelby picked out the American team, and Bob wasn't one of the Americans on the team. And he went to Shelby and he goes, come on, take a chance on me. And Bob, and Shelby goes, we don't have the money to fly you over, Bob. This guy, talk about the heart of a champion, says, if I pay my own way, will you let me be on the American team? And he says, Bondurant, you'll never learn the tracks. So we went to a Burbank bookstore and bought a book full of all the racetracks. Shelby, to let me go, I'll pay my own way. Right. So what did he do? He went and bought a Volkswagen Beetle. And this guy took that little book and he went to every racetrack. In the first year, he beat the 7-time world champion hill climb champion, Ludovico Scarpiotti with Ferrari.
Right.
All because he went in a Volkswagen that had a Ferrari sticker on the back windshield. Okay, we're talking about how you talk yourself
into the next hill. Up and down the, I get up at 4 a.m., drive up and down the hill, because people live there. And I use the whole road.
In a Volkswagen.
In my VW. I figure out which corner you're going, but you're an understeer or oversteer, and then I'm back to bed.
Yep. So we actually have a little notebook that he would like darken the ink where the Volkswagen Bud was going to do one thing, but he knew what the Cobra would do when he took it. So in 1964, what does this guy do? The guy that Carroll Shelby did not want there, he paired up with Dan Gurney for Le Mans. Ferrari had never been beaten in the GT class ever. Dan Gurney had been to Le Mans 4 times and had never finished, never once. Bob takes the car, crosses the finish line, beats Ferrari for the first time in Le Mans history in the GT class. Yeah. That was 1964.
That was great. Wow.
1965, Bob goes back over. Shelby's so busy working on the GT40 that he cannot come to Europe. He has the team over to an English team. Bob gets on board. He wins 7 of the 10 races. And he didn't just win the races. He co-drove with some of the guys. But this is the guy that crossed the finish line. And you know at the end of the day, the guy that crosses the finish line is the one that gets the girl. Just saying. So he did. 7 out of 10.
I had fun.
7, no question. So wins 7 out of 10 races, takes the World Manufacturers Championship. No American had done it before or after in the American car. Bob and Peter Revson, who was the heir to Revlon, he was Bob's teammate. They heard about the Can-Ams. They're like, Can-Ams, those things go faster than Formula One. Well, Enzo Ferrari used to call Bob Bondurant Bondurante Sir Cobra because he kicked his booty all year 1965. Unclenched his hands from the World Manufacturers Championship title, which had never been taken away from Ferrari. He hires Bob Bondurant to race his Formula One Ferraris, his prototypes. Bob finished out a Formula One season. But he and Peter wanted to come over here and race those Can-Ams. Why? Because they were faster. And when there's a faster car, these kind of guys go for the faster car, which is kind of explaining why we went for the higher 8 horsepower here at the school. So we're getting to this amazing history, wins the world, goes for Ferrari, goes into Can-Am, Watkins Glen, he's in a Can-Am, McLaren Mark II, 150 miles an hour, steering arm brakes. And those pictures on that wall, you're welcome to come look at later on, were taken by a 17-year-old kid. And this kid was amazing. He came to us about 10 years ago and said, I just picked up a magazine and it talked about your wreck at Watkins Glen. I have the pictures. So Bob has never seen, back in those days, you never knew what the wreck looked like or how it ended or what your car looked like. The wreck was so bad, he had concussions and broken ribs and he was told he would never walk again because he broke both legs beneath the knees, pro crushed all the bones in his feet and ankles. But what does this guy do? He gets a collar pad in the hospital and says, I'm going to start a driving school. I love training the drivers in the movie Grand Prix. Felt good to my heart. I'm going to do a driving school. So the accident was on June 27, 1967, and he opened up the Bob Bondurant School of High Performance Driving, February 14, 1968, and he was still in a cast. This is the heart of a champion. This is what they do. We will probably never know that. We can see it from a distance. We're outside their bubble looking in, but it's an amazing story. It's a movie is what this guy's life is. But we had a couple of students come through about 2 years ago. They too were teenagers in the crowd. And they said, Bob, we're so happy to finally make full circle and see you after all these years. We were in the stands. The accident happened. Everybody's mumbling. The speakers come over and say, ladies and gentlemen, we're sad to announce that Bob Bondurant has just died. And these boys that are now men said that they were, everything went dead silent, and all you could hear was this cellophane wrapper going across the racetrack. And then the crying, and then the whole thing. Well, the good news is he didn't die, and he is here, and that's what started this school.